The Adventures of Bob Hatson, Casino Project. Chapter 15, The Neighbor. Bob leaves Peterbilt at destination with the trailer and calls John at RCMP to report the situation. He leaves the message that he's tired and need to rest 8 hours. John sent 2 agents to highly secure Bob's truck. During the day, Doc's workers will unload the trailer and secure the merchandise on docks. In 2 different trailers, they will send the merchandise on next day to reach its proper destination. Bob is happy and ready to go to bed at home, where he will not be disturbed by anything. For once, and so rare to be at home in this professional job, Bob enjoys his home ritual. A shower, followed with a glass of red wine, music ambience, then relaxing in a hot bubble bath with a smell of a perfume floating over the water. Sir Hudson is at home now. Bob lives in a great tower on 29th floor in Westmount, Montreal. The Plaza Tower lodges 436 families from all around the world on 33 floors. Accommodating my beautiful neighbor from France, Julie, she rings at my door and asks for sugar. She wears a blue short skirt right up to the top of her thighs. With a black lacy blouse opening the top of her mountain, showing an erected breast. In a plunging neckline, a pearl necklace shines, touching the light black suspenders holding up the little skirt. Cute pearl earrings. You can see the image. Oh, you are here finally, Bob. I thought I heard noise in your apartment. I wanted to be sure you were the one entering. I'm sorry to bother you, Bob, but we didn't see you since long time. She speaks slowly, so you can imagine all the meaning of each word she says. Blonde girl, with sexy white skin, blue eyes, and a certified beautician she is. You can imagine the face of this woman. A wonderful light pink lips, with soft brown makeup on her facial skin today, a ponytail with a blonde forelock covering her forehead, hands the same color as her facial skin, and red nails match her shoes, the same color. A light fragrance to drive all men crazy, including Bob Hatson. She opens her right leg a little, turning her foot on the heel, lifting up her toes. She asks me what she needs. Sugar, please! She knows I would give her all she desires, especially today by the way she impressed me. I don't mind giving my sugar to you, babe, said Bob, but you will have to take a drink with me. I am back from a long trip, and you will understand that I need company to forget my loneliness. If you don't mind, this would be a great pleasure for me to look at you for 5 minutes and exchange words. Well, with this quality of politeness and the punctuality of a king, because if you remember, you told me before you leave that you would be there on this exact day, and I cannot refuse the invitation, Bob. Wonderful, Julie. I'm on my knees to hear about your trip, Robert. Please, please, Bob will represent my personality, lady, if you don't mind. I think your name is Julie, am I right? Yes, you are, and you remember my name, Bob. Well, men who do not remember your name are totally crazy or homosexual. She laughs with the highest society smile, accepting the word homosexual, and she adds, "And they lose something warmer." Picking up the glass of wine in her hand, her lips just touching the cold condensation over the rim of the glass, she first inhales the wine, sucks with her lips, and swallows. With her wide eyes, she looks at me, appreciating this moment like a magical opportunity to better know each other. "May I walk to your window, Bob?"
"Be out of home, please, Julie."
"Oh my God," tells Bob. He looks at her walking with a cute sense of humor in her face. She turns the glass of wine, accomplishing perfect circles, and she says, "What a beautiful view you have from here."
"Well, same as yours, babe. You're my neighbor."
"Oh, sorry. Baby is like treating people as friends in Virginia, Julie," excuses Bob. "Oh, that's okay, Bob. You may call me as you feel it. I know you did travel so much, you may be confused by different language accents sometimes. You must mix them all up, I suppose. Thank you for your understanding, Julie."
"But I like baby, Bob."
"Is that right? Well, let's treat us as friends then." "Well, in fact, my window doesn't offer the same image as yours, Bob. I'm in the angle looking at south, and yours look at east."
"Okay, okay."
Bob approaches while Julie licks her lips, enjoying the wine quality. By a sideways glance, she attracts Bob, and by her hips a secret move, she indicates that a closer caress could be appreciated. Bob stops in the middle of the approach and look at her.
"You know, Julie?"
"What is it, Bob?" "You are a very beautiful woman."
"Oh, thank you, Sir Hudson. I consider this as a great compliment."
"Well, now, are you going to come closer?"
"Closer to the window?" asks Bob.
Bob is a little shy, and she loves this.
"Yes, closer to the window. Where I am, close to the window."
They both start laughing.
"Well, Mr. Hudson is not so easy, hey?"
"Well, I do all I can to resist, but you are so attractive, Julie." Bob slowly makes another step forward, and another one. He is now very close to Julie with her attracting cleavage. Bob will fall in her arms soon. Bob puts a hand on her hip and smells the perfume in her hair and from her earlobe. He distinguishes how beautifully her pearl earrings are so sparkling. Julie takes Bob's other hand and slips it on her hip. Bob behind her whispers in her ear just a few words, and he feels the girl by closing her eyes and holding tight his hands on her hips, falling in his arms like a mature fruit. Bob listening to the music, she balances her body following the rhythm and just touches Bob's belt with her dress. Julie's on fire, and Bob doesn't want to play firefighter. Bob's lips are on Julie's golden neck. Caressing the girl, he looks out the window. They see each other in the shimmering window's glass. "We're above this big town, Bob, and nobody can see us." She brings the glass of wine to her lips, and Bob asks her to give him a sip. She turns around in his arms and softly applies her lips to Bob's wands. She lets a sip flowing out from her mouth, slipping between Bob's lips. Withdrawing a little, she presses her lips against Bob's wand again and sticks them together. Bob lifts up his hands, slowly just touching her skin. Her eyes are so brilliant and pointing up to Bob's eyes. Bob supposes, "It's Niagara Falls down there now, I guess." "What kind of bedroom do you have, Sir Hatsune?"
"Hatsune?" She's French.
"Oh yes, I'll take my hat off soon, baby." Both are laughing, but keeping the atmosphere very romantic. "Don't laugh at me because of my accent, Bob Hatsune, please."
No hats on, Bob engages the loveliest kiss she ever had.
Julie opens her hands and grabs Bob's wands, extracting her body out from Bob.
"Oh!" exclaims Bob. Bob is in heaven, realizing that she's not so easy to seduce. She's so attractive, Bob can't resist. Bob slips his hands behind her and gets her closer to him, both holding tight.
Bob knows what kind of sugar she desires now. As they speak, Bob starts to play with her dress suspenders. She mentions that she never goes to bed on first night. She extends her light fingers over Bob's shoulders. Bob was wearing blue jeans and a white shirt. She plays in Bob's hair as she's looking at the window to let Bob dream a little bit.
Julie says,
"Oh, Bob, so stressed you are. I'm going to use my lips to relax your shoulders. I guess you had a big week."
"Exactly, quite right, Julie.
Well, to pay the sugar I borrow, what can I do for you, Mr. Hatsune?"
Bob lifts up his jeans by the belt. He turns around her and says,
"Me too, I'm not so easy on first time." The moon is shining through the window. Bob can read in her eyes as she smiles.
"Excellent, Sir Hatsune. We both know what we want."
"Well, I bloody know what I want."
"And it's you in these arms, baby." Julie's gorgeous and she knows it.
"Maybe one day we'll be more often together, Bob, and let's see what we can do to see each other more frequently."
"You're right, Julie. Bob Hatsune is a busy man, and time could work on our side."
"Well, you don't plan to let me go like this, Bob, don't you?"
"I would never even imagine doing this to you, my dear neighbor."
"Good," retort Julie. Bob feels anxiety from his last trip, and he prefers to offer the sugar to the lady and try to sleep. Nonetheless, Julie doesn't want to surrender and attack the man, but she thinks maybe later. Bob subtly unclips his jeans and walks towards his bedroom.
"Sugar's on the table, baby. Help yourself."
Smiling, he wants to take his time to satisfy the girl and not only him. Julie makes Bob walking backward until they reach Julie's target. She aims at the chair close to the table. Once there, she slides the chair under Bob's knees. She pulls the man back to comfortably sit him down and talk. Julie is gorgeous. In a head backswing, her hair over her shoulders, breathing slowly and loud, kisses at Bob's lower ear. She whispers of satisfaction as to the height of her epic power. The neighbor looks truly satisfied. Bob stands up with Julie's hands in his man's hands, walk to the window and say,
"You still didn't see my bedroom, isn't it?"
"You're right, Sir Hatsune," with an exciting smile.
"Please indulge me." "Oh my God, by your sense of passion, Sir Hatsune, you drive me crazy. If you ask me again,
I'm baby.
Turn around, baby, asked Bob, and please go home, darling.
Well, I would say that with a girl like you, Miss Neighbor, you shouldn't be surprised about the quality of man you will meet. By the woman's beauty you offer to the man and the quality of your sensual skills and your cleverness, not only Bob Hudson get crazy, but any man would.
Nobody looks at me in this beautiful building, Julie says.
Well, I would say because of your majestic beauty and your high society smile, people must be really impressed and surrender because it's too much for them.
Don't worry, baby, I will look at you.
Thank you so much, Bob. You're my mentor. And I will do everything for you, Bob. She really looks in Bob's eyes and seemed truly impressed by this relation they just had.
Oh, yes, Julie. Me, I will look at you, even if you're under a rainstorm or in a bad moon. I'll be there for you, baby.
I love it when you call me baby, Bob. What a smile a man will never forget.
Her intelligence seems at a high potential to Bob.
With perceptiveness, she's developed what Bob is looking for. Able to organize herself, the lecture she has on the people she meets, and she's not scared of anyone at all. She is absolutely admirable. She just needs some people around her. When she's off, she probably want to meet and have a little fun to forget the seriousness of the week she had.
Okay, baby, Bob must sleep now if he wants to wake up one day. He must use his bed for appropriate matters.
Meaning, sleep well.
Exactly what we're looking for, sir, Julie adds, smiling.
Do you mind if I sleep with you, Bob? Kissing Bob, showing the obviousness of this day's event.
Well, didn't you sleep last night?
I don't want to know what you did last night, but don't you sleep at night like everybody else?
To tell you the truth, Bob, I was expecting you. And when I wait for somebody, I don't sleep pretty tight.
Oh ho, baby, you're knocking me down now.
I hope so. But the truth, I can't miss my shot, Bob.
Let's take it easy, baby, will you?
For now, I'm really tired and not ready for that type of conversation.
I hope you will understand, Julie.
Perfectly, Sir Hudson, I do understand.
And I will let you sleep indeed.
May I sleep with you and prepare a meal for both of us when you wake up? If you don't mind, of course.
Isn't it a good offer, Bob?
Yes, it is, Julie.
Okay, then, you may sleep with me, but I want to sleep.
Yeah, I promise, I swear to God.
Julie sleeps with Sir Hudson, the way she calls him. To show respect to the relation's importance with Bob and the love she wants to bring and share, Julie doesn't want to be conceited, but wants to prepare the best relation as she can by offering the best of her personality. She looks at Bob sleeping and asks herself, what would like Mr. Hudson for breakfast when he wakes up? What would she wear as clothes to impress the man and remain herself? I will not weasel out to all my obligations right now,
because this man is a marvel, thinks Julie. This beautiful man will slow down my aging skin's process, and I would give all I can to be Miss Hudson.
I'd wear my hat soon.
Jealousy will interfere between us. I'll have to put away some aspirants from me and offer the entire place to Bob and engage on a solid romance. Or a little promenade and share some moments to see what he has in mind for the future. Please don't try to change the man, Julie thinks. Sir Hudson is very interesting the way he is now,
and I'll accept his behavior the way he is.
Later on, he will stop traveling and maybe invest together in some holdings around his company and mine, too.
Invest in South for a chalet or a condo.
Costa Rica could be a nice and desirable kingdom for us. After all, I heard about special lots for sale from holaequator.com. Easy price, and later build a house on the lot to spend the winter time under the sun together. A lot of projects, Miss Julie presents to herself. It doesn't cost much to dream. Being in the man's arms you love, therefore, what about him? Is he really alone in his life? Does Sir Hudson have a girlfriend somewhere in Canada or in the States?
Woo, Julie, not too far too fast. Better employ my time to prepare a nice meal and enjoy what we can. On immediate time, she prevails. Approximate analysis of what we want to share together. Only sex, or an entire life's sharing including business, which could be a departure for a longer relation.
Enough, Julie. Try to sleep an hour or two now and enjoy. Julie speaks to herself. She falls asleep beside Bob. 5 hours later, Bob slowly wakes up and feels Julie's arms around him. Bob smells her perfume. Whoa! What an awakening! The awakening of a volcano at sleep. I feel her legs touching mine. In this position, I think she did love the experience we had today. Bob turns on her side and see her eyes at sleep. I will leave my intention in abeyance. She must have dreamed a lot. After a deep sleep, she will easier return on earth. Oh, am I pretentious now? Sorry, folks. This woman is a gift from God. After all, I've been through from my last trip. Bob admires her lips and listen to her breathing. She seems to mean, I love you, Bob Hudson. Well, do I need love or just sexual relation? Who doesn't need love? Her hands are beautiful, offering the strength, power of the beauty, the elegance of a queen, and by her communication, a simple, strong, and clever woman. She has all to succeed in any domains she wants. Talented? I don't know, but for the first time, I would agree that she's very lonesome, despite all the invitations she must receive. If she had been there years ago, I think she would have been mine. Oh, Bob's requests again. Life does not give me an off. The first phrase from Julie after this day will be probably about, what kind of wallet do you prepare, Bob Hudson? Meaning, are you rich, Bob? Well, I see myself answering, well, I'm not rich, darling, but I'm not broke. Is it satisfying the lady enough? Or by what other indignation will I have to pass through? I do not want to pass through a contemptuous rejection of myself because I didn't behave properly. I just feel safe with her. She really doesn't look like a pack of trouble. No children, it doesn't mean she doesn't want some. Do we want some by the careers we have? Claiming that the future is a nice challenge for both of us, with all it consists, we could prepare nice older days. Let's light up some candles so she feels at home when she wakes up. She only caught a glimpse of me in this little party. Bob slips out of the bed and turns on the shower. The man feels on vacation now.
No phone, realizing that this is a strange but a love's wheeler-dealer story and, in confusion with my own recognition, I now must live with this whim. Was it just a whim? Alternatively, I really want this girl closer to me and improve my life's pattern when I'm at home. What I really know is that this girl dwells in the same building as I do, and circumstances will make us meet again. Bob feels flattered. Candles, shimmering lights in Bob's kingdom. In the kitchen, the music is on. Nice, calm instrumental, standard jazz playing. And to seduce the fortress's queen, Bob installs two glasses of wine on the table. He calls first floor security and asks them to let enter the florist with flowers later. Bob goes to shower. Julie is still sleeping without snoring. She's perfect, assents Bob. A half an hour later, Bob is out of the bathroom, fresh shaved, with a little Mackey perfume. Awfully colorful, this gentleman slightly over exposes his charm to one of the most beautiful beautician he met in his life. Why not consider and appreciate the mysterious moment after all? Maybe she's a double agent. She could make money with bad stories and might be in business with fraudulent characters. Never know. In addition, perhaps she shows false feelings to exploit business-like inventions, which I'm the creator, or showing a divine interest for music she could like and squeeze my rights. Never know, Bob imagines. Okay, Bob, take a break and enjoy this moment, Bob murmurs. The angel is still sleeping. Well, where is the girl who wanted to prepare a meal for me at my awakening? Well, I'm not sure this was a real desire. Let's say after this approach, she might take a break. Oh, ho! I think I hear yawns from the woman celebrating the possession of my bedroom. Oh, she has a nice voice, even when she just woke up. Isn't that nice of her? Does she love music? Does she sing? Could she sing in a song with me? Oh, a girl like this doesn't need to sing at all. She possesses all the rest. Bob pours a little sip of orange juice in a glass. He brings in the other hand a bottle of vodka, just in case. Hello, Miss Neighbor. Bob, in a tight blue jeans and a white V-neck shirt, offers Julie the fresh drink. By your goodness, Bob, I was sleeping all this time. Well, lady, you were gorgeous in your dreams. In fact, you don't speak while you're dreaming. Okay, I'm happy to hear this, gentlemen. I didn't reveal any disturbing subjects then. Nope, you did not. Would you like some vodka in your drink, Julie?
Are you crazy, Bob Hatson? I just woke up. Could you give me the gist of my dreams now?
Certainly not. You didn't say a word, darling. I just woke up an hour before you. If you said something, I was sleeping too. It's glaringly obvious that we were both far away from here, baby. If you want to shower, everything's ready for you in the bathroom. Or if you want to take a bath, I will prepare it for you.
Well, Mr. Hatson, I would prefer a hot bath. And I'll go home to take it, if you don't mind.
And I'll enjoy wearing new clothes. Oh, okay, by the time you're gone, I would like to prepare a good supper for us, if you're available, obviously.
Oh my God, I didn't live up to my promise from yesterday. I wanted to prepare a meal for us, but I fell asleep and goodbye. I was gone in my dream, Bob.
I'll receive all I need in 5 minutes to prepare the meal, says Bob.
Oh, okay then. Next time will be for me to prove my gratitude. I'm sure you will, Julie.
Thanks for the delicious orange juice, and I'll be back in 1 hour if you agree.
Yes, I do.
By that time, I will cook. I love to prepare food, in fact, and impress my guests.
Oh, don't impress me too much, sir. I will stick on your doorsteps.
Kissing goodbye, Julie puts her clothes on and escapes for 1 hour. Bob couldn't finish his phrase. He receives the food and flowers with a message from downstairs security.
Message? Hello, Bob. Having a good time?
Everything's under control. Merchandise is safe, and you will receive all you need for truck's damages. We'll be in touch tomorrow.
Bob asks to the delivery man, who brought this message?
His name is John, sir.
Okay, thank you. Bob generously pays the delivery man and shuts the door.
Now it's time for cooking. Bob pours himself a glass of red wine.
He starts preparing vegetables, salad, cheese, and the filet mignon for later, just before Julie comes back. Flowers on a little table beside.
Stencils ready. Glasses ready for wine.
Bob feels like he's playing music. He pulls out his acoustic Gibson guitar and starts writing a song for Julie.
Praising Diva's beauty, Bob requires his talent to write a part on a beautician in love.
In love with the beauty of a woman, which is revealed by her high standing, in her entertaining clothes, wearing most mysterious earrings for Bob's eyes, she shines. A song that talks about her language and how sexy she is. The impression she leaves to her lover after a curious visit at home, looking for sugar, and let's call her Miss Sugar. Rarely a woman offering such talent and with extremely graceful moves, wears earrings like she does. Pearl earrings. Preparing a supper that Julie will remember to make her feel comfy, Bob resumes the song by a virtual love but expresses all he can about the beauty of the woman. Love is not what he's looking for, but desires are stronger than love exploring dreams. Desires prevail over the vow. With enthusiasm, Bob's eyes are sparkling when the lady knocks at the door.
For fun, Bob answers, opening the door. Another sum of money?
Asks Bob.
What? Oh, I'm sorry, sir. I've knocked at the wrong door.
Julie, with a simple smile, playing the game. The woman is actually sublime. Bob, in full dedication, praises the woman to enter his kingdom. Julie walks in and Bob follows her steps.
Remarkable, Miss Neighbor, your outfit.
Thank you, Bob. Oh, it smells good in the kitchen.
Yes, and I hope you will enjoy what I've prepared for us.
Oh, I'm sure you analyzed each meal's portion to satisfy my taste buds.
Julie wears a thin white scarf on her shoulders, with 2 small brown deer on each side.
Splendid! Everything suits you, Julie.
May I open this scarf to give my neighbor a kiss, please?
Yes, you may, Bob.
Julie takes a few steps aside and say,
what do I hear now? Is this Bob's voice singing?
Well, for my guest tonight, I wrote a song to celebrate the most casual moment of the week.
I confess to my neighbor that I'm very happy to meet a woman who understands a man like me, despite all rumors about me in this building.
Oh, Bob, none of these rumors exist on you in this building.
All the people want to have Bob Hudson near them, and each requests,
where is Sir Hudson this week? We miss him.
This is a beautiful song, Bob.
Julie submits to listen.
Thanks, Julie. I wrote this song for you and me. No scandalizing words, and I open my kingdom to the ruby you are. My neighbor, no scandalous gossips. Just great stories to join the letters and create words lying on the music. Discovering every day from a new well where love never ends. Come here, Bob Hatson, Julie offers Bob a kiss. Her arms around his neck so tight, she pushes her little belly against Bob's belt. Okay, love, but we have to take care of filet mignon now. Ooh, I love this type of steak occasionally, Bob. Bob cooks as serving a dry martini to Julie. Supper's finally ready. I will pull the chair for the comfort of my beautician, said Bob. Would you please, my dear? Julie bends her knees, accepting the chair. She wears a blue skirt, open on the side of her left thigh. Very exciting, crossing her legs. The left thigh appears and the man's desire grows up. Bob the cook, surrounding his prize, says, Cheers to the lady, striking crystal glasses. Congratulations to Bob Hatson, says Julie. I recorded this song while you were gone, babe. Very often, only one simple recording without rehearsals brings the natural beauty of a simple success. Just one voice and an acoustic guitar sometimes can offer a miraculous song. We can hear Julie singing the chorus with Bob. Reading words, raising their glasses, they sing together till the end of the song. Hey, my neighbor, you sing pretty well. Congratulations, lady. I like your voice. Do you exercise every morning, Julie? No, I'm afraid not, Bob. But I used to sing as a back vocal when younger I was. Oh, you must have been beautiful as a singer. I see you on stage, Bob says. Hey, ladies and gentlemen, the tonight's star, Julie Neighbor, the Duchess of the country rock music style, a steel voice in a velvet glove. Please welcome Julie Neighbor, Bob with a charming voice adds, singing a song with Bob Hatson. Julie Neighbor, hee-haw! Very attractive woman on stage, signatures, autographs, handshakes, Julie the star. Funny, Bob, but I prefer you on stage. Is that right? Wonderful creature you are, Julie. Julie asks, What would you think if I'd go with you on a truck trip, Bob? Oh, baby. After the week I had, I advise you to wait for this project. Bob Hatson often turns around danger, trying to solve problems and help colleagues. You and I, Julie, were born to be together at home. It's where I see both of us in this program as beautiful lovers without questions about our private lives. Without talking business between us would mean no confusion. How about a cup of coffee, Julie? Thanks, Bob. I'll continue with my glass of wine, please. You know, Bob Hatson, I could ask for a big ransom for you. Julie stands up. Under emotion, turning aside her feet on high heels, she slowly walks looking at Bob. Exciting, Sir Hatson. There's a big demand for a diamond like you, Bob. Her left hand swaying her blonde hair, and by a sway of her hip, she attacks Bob with her hands on his belt. What are you talking about, a ransom? Asked Bob. Nobody will spend a token on me, darling. In transport, I'm pollution for some people. In music, I am totally independent. And in sound engineering, Ooh, la, 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 blah, 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 Sir Hatson. And in love? Demands Julie. An expert, babe.
Julie exclaims. Bob tries to escape, but the beautician holds him tight.
And now, Sir Hudson, I will take my dessert.
Okay, okay, Miss Neighbor the beautician. Your request is order, but not tonight.
What are you talking about, Sir Hudson?
Well, we'll see how you react
to this offer, asks Julie.
We will see how Sir Hudson will resist to the charm of a beautician.
Her eyes under the silver moon by the window drive Bob completely crazy.
This type of woman must be threatened of extinction, Bob yells.
Oh, following the music Bob had turned on.
Oh, Sir Hudson, I never had a good dessert like this.
Oh, Julie, I really appreciate the way you talk.
You're fantastic.
You're really exciting me, babe. So attractive you are, Julie.
Thanks, Bob. This evening is not over yet, Julie declares.
Oh, let me sit over you, baby. Oh, yes, I love your nice little way to attract me.
Bob is up to the sky, caressing Julie. He kisses his beautician right on her lips, expressing how thankful he feels.
The evening is not over yet, Julie exclaims.
Okay, lady, my comprehension's rate is very high tonight.
Cool, Bob.
They kiss each other, thinking the same thing, and they say at the same time,
a glass of wine, baby? They start laughing.
Bob walks to the kitchen and come back with the bottle of wine.
Well, it's good to be at home, says Bob.
You bet, Bob. A magical story like this should exist every day.
Dying sleeping together could be a wonderful death.
I guess so, Bob nods. Pouring a little bit of wine in the lady's glass, Bob asks Julie,
you were talking about a ransom for me earlier. Then how much would you ask for your hostage?
Well, after what we've had tonight, there is no price for my hostage.
Not negotiable.
Well, you have to negotiate if you want to make money out of my ransom.
Well, it depends. Maybe I don't need money.
Negotiations exist on many different levels. And the level here we had in sex and love.
I mean, this type of love is not negotiable for me, because there's no money for that type of pleasure.
Oh, I see what you mean. There's no price to equal that pleasure.
Exactly, sir.
I'll drink to that.
Julie in Bob's arms admires by the window the sky full of stars.
This night's beautiful, Bob, and I'm very happy to be here with you.
My ransom for you is that you come back to me, Julie, whenever you want.
Each time I'm in Montreal, if we have a chance to meet, would be highly considerate.
Downtown is waiting for us to give them news.
The beautician and the trucker were together last night. Can you imagine the cinema, Julie says.
And for me, Bob, the important is not what the others think, but what we live together.
Each and every moment is magical if we consider that we just met you and me.
A very fresh relation we are in, Bob.
And this is beautiful.
Bob reads in her eyes the charm of her thoughts and how impressive the way she gives herself to the man.
A night like this with a woman like her, whoa, it's the accomplished mystery of simple love.
Julie is a cougar girl, Bob realizes.
Are you a cougar girl, Julie, if it's not too personal?
Well, you may say that, Bob. It depends on how the relation occurs and grows.
It's not beyond the bounds of the possible to change boys, Bob, Julie said.
A cougar girl is a woman between 35 and 50 years of age, often after her family time is done and children are raised.
She splits from the couple because of a platonic routine where they just don't see each other anymore. She looks eventually for a short adventure with a younger boy. A boy toy. She experiments new sex adventure, and usually not for a long time because she doesn't want to feed the boy, but have sex with him. She's financially independent and look for an adventure while she finally takes care of herself and her body.
Interesting.
Julie's a wonderful woman who knows what she wants and presents all symptoms of the magical cougar woman. Nonetheless, it's a marvel to share an invitation to debauchery with her.
Julie, you make me...
Bob? Okay, understands Bob. Julie reaches home after this magic moment with the neighbor. Neighbor that she'll never forget now, and probably Bob too. Had fun, folks?